Chapter 31, the last chapter. Chapter 31, if you look at the title of your chapter in your book, in your Bible, Wisdom of King Lemuel. Now, who is King Lemuel? Lemuel. It also got a Jewish name. You see all the E-L-E-L, you know, Joel, Samuel, the E-L is God. You see, he's Jewish. Joel, O-L. Okay, do this. H-O-E, my name, right? Add one L. Anyway, Wisdom of King Lemuel. But scholars said, likely, it was Solomon. It was Solomon. But no very clear evidence and so on. But we read the words that are recorded here. You make a guess, you can't go wrong. Solomon is the guy referred to. So what we see here, the words of King Lemuel, the utterance which his mother taught him. So, what did his mother teach Solomon? Now, mind you, Solomon came from Bathsheba, right? And the union with David came from Bathsheba. And this wasn't exactly her first child, because the first child died. Out of the union with David, the child died. Then later, another one. So Solomon. And she must have seen enough in the life of David. And so now as the mother, she was going to teach her son, Solomon. So in verses 1 to 9, we find, first of all, she said, no women. Now, David got one wife or more than one. More than one. So Solomon, don't be like your dad. No women. Verses 4 to 7, in her life, she must have seen, they throw grand parties and so on. And when you get drunk, things are a bit out of hand. So, no wine. And next, no injustice. 8 to 9. Don't be unfair and unjust to your people. Rule with justice. So this we shall study shortly. So verse 2. What my son? Now what my son, if you expand it, it's what can I say to you, my son? Just so you understand the thing better. Otherwise, it's just what, my son? Yeah. What can I say? What did she want to say to Solomon? So, what, my son? What and what, son of my womb? Of course. And what, son of my vows? Now, she likely must have been like what Hannah did. Hannah, because she was desperate to have a child, she prayed unto the Lord and she made a vow. And so the Lord blessed her with little Samuel. So this Bathsheba must have also prayed to the Lord after the first child has passed away. She was probably sad and prayed to the Lord for another. And she must have made some vows. So, Solomon came. And what? Son of my vows. Verse 3. Do not give your strength to women, nor your ways that to that which destroy kings. So, do not give your strength to women. Don't give your energy, you know, your wealth. In other words, don't waste yourself. You waste yourself physically, you waste yourself financially. When you got too many women around you, all the mistresses and harem and so on. Yeah. No your ways to death, which destroy kings. And kings of those days, they are polygamous. Means not monogamous. Mono means one wife. Polygamy. Polygamous. Many, like even David, polygamous. And as a result, the families suffered. So you look at Proverbs 6:32. That was one advice we studied some months back. Whoever commits adultery with a woman lacks understanding. And he does so, he who does so destroys his own soul. So when you sleep with another woman who is not your wife, there are soul ties because it is between two persons. So you destroy your soul. So here, the mother gave the first advice, no women. Did the son pay attention?
No.
No. How many he ended up with? 1,000. 1,000. 700 wives, 300 concubines. I tell you, the mother fainted. Never pay attention. Okay? Verse 4. It is not for kings, O Lemuel, it is not for kings to drink wine, nor for princes, which are the leaders under the king, nor for princes intoxicating drink, strong drink, lest they drink and forget the law and pervert the justice of all the afflicted. So, don't give them, don't take strong drinks, lest they cannot do the job that they are supposed to do and justice is perverted. Give strong drink, however, give strong drink to him who is perishing. Now, perishing, this is, yeah, maybe the guy is on deathbed, about to die and so on, maybe to lessen his pain. Okay, but it could also mean an unbeliever. This guy is ready, you know, he just reject God and anti-God and so on. Okay, lah, let him have his drink. He's doomed anyway. Okay. But Paul also told Timothy, have some wine for your stomach, because Timothy's stomach was a bit problematic, unsettled. And wine to those who are bitter of heart, depressed. Take some wine. Like someone wrote to me last night, he was so angry with some things. I'm so angry, I'm drinking. Wow, I don't think that's the right solution. Right? You're angry, there are other solutions, right? And if you are angry and you drink, what do you need to tell me? I mean, funny, right? Anyway, and why to those who are bitter of heart? There is a solution for people who are bitter of heart. No need to resort to drink. Anyway, verse 7, let him drink and forget his poverty and remember his misery no more. This is just escapism. You're running away from the problem. Then when you wake up from your stupor, after your drunkenness, the problem is still there. Right? You are not solving the problem. But anyway, the mother said, let all these people drink, but you don't drink. That's what the mother said, right? No wine. Yeah. They all can drink, all those who are sick, depressed, bitter, you know, miserable, let them drink, but you don't drink. Okay? Then, we have the last one, no injustice. The third advice she gave to him, open your mouth, verse 8, for the speechless. In the cause of all who are appointed to die. Some people are sentenced to death and they are defenseless. They don't have money to employ lawyers, engage lawyers. And those days, the rich get richer, like today, the poor gets poorer. They have no one, they got no money to bribe the judges and so on. They can't. So in the cause of all who are appointed to die, be honest, be just, and be fair. Defend them. Open your mouth, judge righteously, and plead the cause of the poor and needy. Did Solomon do that? Did Solomon do that? These people who don't have a voice, did he do that? Initially he did. Remember, he asked God. God said, what do you want? He said, give me wisdom. Then the first test case came before him. Yeah. Hey, no. Mixed up lah. We woke up this morning mixed up. I don't know whose baby. Then, no, this is my baby. Then the woman said, it's her baby. Then Solomon said, okay, split lah. The other one. Okay, split. Then he know who's the real mother. The real mother said, no, I'd rather give it away than split it, right? Mm-hmm. So he was covered. Otherwise, hey, please, you all prostitutes or whatever, you all going to take care of your own thing, I got no time for you. Then they go fight it out. One take the head, one take the tail. But he started well. But later, as just now we read in 1 Kings chapter 11, chapter 12, Jeroboam, because Rehoboam didn't do a good job. They came to him and said, hey, your father was quite tough on us, referring to Solomon. Can you make it easier on us? Then he talked to his young, wise generation. Then they came back. No. He said, no. What my father did, I'll do worse to you. And so the kingdom split, right? But the point is, your father was tough to us. So he did not end it well. You know why? Wealth and pleasure and all. We will see more of this when we go to Ecclesiastes. Has gotten to him. He has lost his focus. So this mother didn't exactly succeed in mothering or parenting very well. No women, no wine, no injustice. Not exactly the advice Solomon took to heart. Okay? So now we go on to PMC class. The rest of this is about a virtuous wife and mother. And so appropriate, tomorrow is Mother's Day. Yeah, the Lord bless you for your faithfulness, even in serving Him as a God-fearing mother. So you find here, I believe, even as Solomon penned these words under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he was recalling his mother. He was remembering his mother. And as we go through all these verses, he will remember that his mother is one who had hands that work. You know, she had a mouth that spoke well, and she had a heart that loves. And that's how he remembered her. And all these are captured within the verses here. And the other thing you might want to know is from verses 10 to 31. This proverb is written in acrostic manner. You know it's acrostic by now. That means the next verse takes on the next letter of the Hebrew alphabet. The Hebrew alphabet, just like our English alphabet, we have A, B, C, D, and so on. So each new verse starts with the next letter in the alphabet system. So you start your first verse with A, second verse with B. And so this is the Hebrew alphabet. And the verse starts with the following letters of each and every letter in the alphabet. You understand?
Yes.
Okay. There's an acrostic. Okay, verse 10. Who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. Who can find? So I underline in my Bible, find. So just 2 nights ago, I was teaching my PMC class on this, chapter 31. Hey, so that means must do work. Must do work. you are not king the world. You sit down there, the whole world all come to you, and then you can pick and choose. Go and do some work. Who can find? So you must sit diligently. Choose the right one. Who can find a virtuous wife? Virtuous, morally pure. And importantly, the fear of God. Shouldn't choose someone who is unequally yoked with you. So, who can find a virtuous woman? For her worth is far above rubies. Rubies are precious stones. I think if you go to Myanmar, you can find a lot, right? But even then, they don't exist on the surface of the ground. You got to dig. Dig. Effort. Takes effort. So, take effort to go and find your ruby. It is invaluable. It is priceless. It is expensive. But still, when you find, it shall be a blessing unto you. Verse 11. 11 and 12. I have divided all this into characteristic of the mother or the wife. So what do we see? Verse 11 and 12. A trustworthy woman. How so? The heart of her husband safely trusts her. So he will have no lack of gain. He trusts her with the finances. So he has entire confidence in her. I mean, imagine, in those days they are the farmers, right? Agricultural. So he goes out into the field to tend to the field, the animals and whatever. But hey, what's happening to my wife? She is not doing anything. She's idle. You know, she spent all the money and not looking after the household. But not so. He went forth knowing that he can entrust the household to his wife. And so they say, behind every successful woman is a
trustworthy
wife, faithful wife, everything like fill in the blanks, okay? Fill in your name. So he will have no lack of gain. He will prosper. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She does him good and not evil. She pleases him because she loves him. She does with the best of interest, his interest at heart. That's what she does. All the days of her life, as long as she is alive, she will do her utmost for her husband. But you can also put there his life, because sometimes he goes first. So she will do all the best for him. Then, verses 13 to 15, industrious, hardworking, mother of the year award. She seeks wool and flax and willingly works with her hands. She seeks wool and flax. Now, this is to make thread and linen. Where do you find them? On the ground. Go to the tree and pluck. No. From the sheep. Hey. But to shear the sheep and so on. She has to work. Okay? It is not like those, if you go to those shops and then just buy some thread, buy some button, buy some needles and then sew. She has to seek them and use them and make them and use them to make threads and linen and willingly works with her hands. So those days are no Uniqlo, no H&M, no ready-made. She has to do it and she did it willingly. All these are done in love. She is like the merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. That means she goes to great length to get food for the family. Now, Israel is located inland, I mean the land, right? the sea border is the Mediterranean Sea. And then those days, hey, the ship takes many months to travel from Europe, whatever, to bring the things from Africa, coffee and so on. But she will go from where she is, she'll go to the seashore and to get the food for her household. She went to great lengths. So mommy dearest will go to Chinatown and get the herbs for you, Pothong, right? She will go to Jason supermarket, NTUC not good enough. You know, she will go to cold storage or wherever. She goes to great lengths. She also rises while it is yet night, and provides food for her household and a portion for her maid servants. She rises while it is yet night. She doesn't love her bed too much, so no need to buy her expensive bed. It means she is not lazy. She is industrious. Okay? So, here we see a woman who is industrious. And she provides food for her household. She plans well the rations. It's not like, hey, run out of food, larder don't have, fridge don't have, empty, never stock up. But she plans well. And if you see the word there, household, household, it is more than the family. And you read even in Acts chapter 16:31, Paul said to the jailer, yeah, you and your household shall be saved. That means everyone who stays under your roof is not just you and your family, the cat and the dog as well. No, but it includes the slaves, the servants. They also be provided. But we still read in the papers today, right? Educated people, business people, bosses, executives, the way they ill-treat their mates. I cannot understand. It's like all these events don't frighten them. These people get jailed as well, they don't frighten them. It's like, catch me if you can. I continue to ill-treat my mate. If I get caught, I go to jail. But if I don't get caught, I continue. Then you ask, where is the fear? Whether fear of God or fear of the law, where is the fear? And a portion for her maid servants' household. Okay, now we go on to the third one, verses 16 to 19. She is resourceful. Verse 16, she considers, that means not impulsive, not suddenly feel like buying. She considers a field and buys it. So her work arena is not confined to the home. She also looks beyond the home. She is resourceful. The field and buy it. Businesswoman, she is really financially independent. From her profits, she plants a vineyard. From her profits, that means her labor is fruitful. She doesn't toil and catch nothing. And she used the profits to what? To reinvest. But some people squander the thing, make a bit of money, spend. Wow. Gets lottery, 1 million, 1 million gone. Buy share, make some money, wow, also gone. But she reinvests. Verse 17, she girds herself with strength and strengthens her arm. She perceives that her merchandise is good and her lamp does not go out by night. So she has a very healthy attitude towards work. And she perceives that her merchandise is good. So she knows how to be selective. She knows how to choose well. And she works hard. And her lamp does not go out by night. That means she does overtime. They say the man works from sunrise to sunset. But the woman's work is never done. Right? She continues to work. Not mahjong. Okay? And she stretches out her hands to the distaff. And her hands and a hand holds the spindle. So you can imagine the sewing machine. But those days, the sewing machine is actually the distaff and the spindle, where she will spin her own thread and weave the cloth. That's what she did, even at night. This is manual skill. She is resourceful. And yet she is also compassionate. Verse 20. She extends her hand to the poor. Yes, she reaches out her hands to the needy. She is generous. She is compassionate. She is charitable. She is giving out. And that is really, commendable. But some people is just I, me, and my family. But she is more than that. Verse 21 to 24, we see that she is prudent. She is not afraid of snow for her household. For all her household is clothed with scarlet. She is not afraid of snow. Remember a few chapters earlier, we studied the fool and said, hey, it is winter. Don't want to go out. Yeah, no. In between October, November, and so on, you don't go out and plow the land and sow the seeds. Come April, no harvest, no. But you see, it's cold. Yeah, it's cold. But still, you must keep plowing. You must keep toiling. Otherwise, come April, no harvest. So this mother, this wife, she is not afraid of snow for her household. So she went out and she did the necessary to keep her family warm. She, her family is clothed with scarlet. Scarlet is what color? Rain. So she did dress her family in ash cloth and black and dark. Dress them in lively colors. Verse 22, she makes tapestry for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Tapestry for herself. And that is for decoration. To decorate the house. Maybe the dining table, whatever. She did it well. And it speaks of beauty. Her clothing is fine linen. And purple. Hey, you know purple is the color of royalty, right? So she also dressed well. Nobody asked you to dress like auntie, dress like purple. No need. Dress well. When we dress well, we feel well, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So dress well. That's what she did. Purple. And I like this one, verse 23. And because of all that she has done, her husband is known in the gates. When he sits among the elders of the land. You know, by now the gate is the area where the people of the city congregate for civic matter, for legal matter, for financial matter. That's where their town hall is. They all gather. Wow, when they gather all the only men, right? When they all gather, hey, your wife, my champion. Meanwhile, she is doing all the work. And you notice what he was doing. Verse 23. He only said, when he sits among the elders, she's doing all the work, he just sits there and look good. So behind every successful man is a hardworking wife. Okay? Anyway, that's what she did. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. So this wife honors her husband, not disgrace her. Imagine if she's fooling around, lazy and whatever. You think this man will have the audacity to sit in the gate? They throw slipper at him. You are such a shame to our community. But not so. But you must study this in context, because in Ephesians 5:25, in order for the wife to submit to the husband must first do what? Love the wife. And the more you love your wife, the more your wife will submit to you. This husband must have loved the wife much. And so she submits to his will. Okay. Verse 24, she makes the linens of she made linen garments and sells them and supplies sashes for the merchants. So you see, she is an entrepreneur. She is in the trading business. She makes and she sells. Verse 25. Strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in time to come. So what are her characteristics and what is her conduct? Strength. That means she's firm, not fickle. And honor, that means she has dignity. She can hold her head up. She shall rejoice in time. Pain now, suffering now, but pleasure shall come. And if you are faithful in this time here, you shall be rewarded. Jesus said, enter into the joy of the Lord. She shall rejoice then. So, next, we have verse 26. It speaks of this wife who speaks well. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. So it's not only men who speaks well, woman also speaks well. And she opens her mouth with wisdom. Wisdom is not because you are man or woman. Wisdom is because you have the word of God in you. And you have the Holy Spirit in you, guiding you. That's wisdom. And on her tongue is the law of kindness. And I can think of Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit. Imagine some people, the way they open mouth with the tongue hits you. Okay, plus saliva too. Okay? And you don't enjoy that kind of conversation. Very biting. But not this wife. Verse 27, she watches over the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness, which is similar to earlier ones. Her children, wow, this one is good. Her children rise up and call her blessed. She is blessed. And when kids wake up, how often your kids wake up in the morning? Daddy, God bless you. Daddy, mommy, God bless you. But they do. And not only her children, her husband too. Grateful husband, grateful children. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. You know what he just said? You are number one. There are many women around, many daughters around, but you are number one. You know, that's what he said. You excel them all. When she hears this, she will give him bacon and egg for breakfast. No burnt offering today. I will serve you good breakfast. And all this undeserving and they are necessary. Even as the husband is blessed, he should also praise and thank her in Jesus Christ. Okay, then. Now, Solomon left the best for the last. We can talk about all the qualities of the virtuous wife and mother and so on, but the last quality, if it is absent, it will nullify everything that we have just studied about trustworthy, industrious, resourceful, compassionate, prudent, and speaks well. Why? Because if you do not fear God, if you do not obey God, then everything else is wasted. So he left the best for the last. Verse 13. Charm is deceitful and beauty is passing. Is this external or internal? External. So don't bother to do Botox. And wear Chanel. No, do whatever you need to do. And so on. Okay, I'm not saying. But what I'm saying, not what I'm saying, what the Bible is saying, it's all this external. It's good, but don't forget the internal. Okay? Don't forget the internal. Charm is deceitful and beauty is passing. No matter what we do, to ourselves, but still, eventually, we will age physically. The muscles, the tissues, and all those will be quite different than when we were years ago. But a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. The woman who worships God, who obeys God, and reveres God, she shall be praised. And the word there is shall. That is a promise. It is not maybe. She shall be praised. Verse 31. Give her of the fruit of her hands. Because she has labored, she will have fruits. So give her the fruit of her labor. It cannot be she's striving for the family, but she gets nothing. Give her of the fruit of her hands. And you know something? And though she's not sitting at the gate like the husband is sitting, but her works will be known even at the gates. And God be praised. And let her own works praise her in the gates. So she doesn't need to go and do self-promotion. Though she doesn't sit there, but her fruits will be known and she shall be praised. So, to summarize this verse 10 to verse 31, just three things. To the PMC class, and that's why I told them, so I say this the same to you. For the ladies, a lot of things to chase. Oh, must be trustworthy, industrial. You know what the wife would say? Out of stock. Now you can't find anything. Non-existent anymore. Okay, a lot of things, right? My advice is: shoot for the stars. Yeah. If you miss, you still land on the moon. You understand? Means, do your best. Do your best in every way. If you miss some, you might still get others. But if you aim nothing, you will surely get it. You understand? You aim for nothing, you will get nothing. So shoot for the stars. I tell all the girls in the PMC class, marriage is an institution. It is a lifelong journey and never work at it. A lot of things to work at, both of them. If you miss some, you might still get others. But better than not trying, not doing anything. Okay, for the guys, I tell them, make yourself deserving of such a woman. And I tell you, if I ask for a show of hands, whether here or in church or anything, how many of you think your husband deserves a loving wife? How many things don't deserve? Wow, hands all gone. Right? So sometimes we are a bit complacent, a bit negligent. We are not perfect. So I tell the guys, hey, make yourself worthy of such a woman. So you must also do your part to support your wife, to love her, so that you give her the ability to perform and fulfill the role that she has been called for, to be a God-fearing wife. But if I'm standing in a way, I'm blocking her, I'm putting her down, criticizing her, and every day she gets so discouraged, nothing will be done. Okay? And then the last one is, we as the bride of Christ. So we have the man, we have the lady. Now we as the bride of Christ. Yeah. What must we do? We must be pleasing to him because he's the bridegroom. So we must be pleasing to our Lord Jesus, both positionally, means our place in Christ, but also practically. So we want to please our Jesus, the bridegroom. We are the bride. So we want to please him positionally. Hey, I accepted you as my Lord and Savior. I am in the Lamb's Book of Life. I am saved. Positionally, I'm a Christian. I'm not an unbeliever. Positionally, I'm saved. But I also want to please my Lord. We also want to please our Lord practically. That means we go and apply what we learn. You understand? Under that, yes, I love you, dear. I love you, dear. But you did nothing. So your words must be translated to action. Okay? So, I don't think I have time to start the introduction of Ecclesiastes. Maybe it is better than we wait until we resume. Now, for those who came later, our next lesson is 11th of June. 1 month break. Okay. I will then start the book of Ecclesiastes.
You can send us the intro.
Can I can send you the slides and so on. Yeah, you can start copying. You should finish by then. 1 month. So come, Father, we just want to thank you for the wisdom that you have given to us, even through the pages of the book of Proverbs. And it remains us to just now to say and to acknowledge you are the author who has got the very best of our interests at heart. And our response is to walk in wisdom henceforth and always, and to live the Proverbs every day of our lives. Lord, there is so much we can do, even on a day-to-day basis, for ourselves, for our families, and even for our community. And in so doing, Lord, we shall lift up high the banner of God, that people will see and they'll praise your wonderful name in heaven. Thank you, Father, once again. In Jesus' name. Amen.